Well, welcome to Foothills Christian Church. The mission of our church is first and foremost to connect you to Jesus Christ. We want you to not just know about him, but we want you to know him directly. And then we want you to be connected to community. No matter how big the church gets, it always feels small to you because you're connected in a smaller group for the purpose of discipleship. We learn in rows, but we really grow in circles. And that's an important principle of who we are as a church. And once you are connected to Christ and you start to grow in discipleship, that's when you discover your mission and purpose in life. Apart from God, it's nearly impossible to discover a purpose in life. And so that's what we're all about. And so if you're here for the first time, we're so glad you're here. If you're watching for the first time online or you're doing church at home, you are so glad that you're here. You can scan this QR code and learn more about us. It takes you to a few 3-minute videos. It just introduces us a little bit more. Because we're so concerned about people being connected to Jesus Christ, baptism is a part of your journey of faith. And so we set aside as the first Sunday of every month in order to keep a focus on baptism. And so the last Sunday of the month, which is today, we want you to go to a baptism of believers meeting if you have questions about what does it mean to be baptized? How do you get baptized? How does it work? You can just go, if you're on campus, right out by the chapel after each service. And if you're online watching, you can just text FH Baptism and to 72,000, and you can kind of see the same questions being answered. So we encourage you to do that. We love baptizing people here on campus, but we will baptize anybody, anywhere, anytime. We just get it taken care of because it's a big deal to us. Now, we're in a series called My Political Jesus. And the political environment in America is forcing people, especially Christians, to kind of respond to what's going on. People have a lot of expectations about what their involvement should be. So the first week we talked about how Jesus is being used as kind of a political football. And everybody wants Jesus to be behind whatever their political position or opinion might be. So the question we tried to answer is, well, because politics are getting so high pressure and they want everybody everywhere to be involved, what exactly is the church doing to respond? And I organized what I see is the kind of the general responses out there into four categories. The first one is the Benedictine option, and this is basically the option where we are encouraged to withdraw from the world and basically let the world just pass on by and just kind of ignore it. The second one is a Charlemagne option. This is based on the Holy Roman Emperor Charlemagne in the 7th and 8th centuries, and I haven't talked a lot about it. It's more of a lesser type approach. It's not really big or broad. It's based on dominion theology, which comes out of the apostolic reform movement in America today, which is really not a major movement in Christianity, Orthodox classic Christianity. Then there's the embrace everything option, and this is more along the lines of progressive Christianity. And then the one that seems to be most common for everybody is the don't pick sides option. And the don't pick sides option has been re-articulated by Andy Stanley, who's a major kind of a classic or Orthodox Christian evangelical leader. And he just wrote a book called Not In It to Win It. When the church picks sides, the church gets sidelined. And so he's like, hey, don't pick sides, just stay out of it. That's different than the first one, which is completely remove yourself. The fourth one is, well, stay involved, but just don't pick sides. Try to always be the referee, so to speak. The second week, what we did is we said, what should you expect from your church? If you're involved in politics a lot, or you want to stay out of politics, what should you expect from your church? And what we kind of dug into is the Bible teaches that, well, if the church gets off mission, and one of these options kind of becomes too prevalent, that distracts the church from what God intended it to do. However, God intended it to influence values. Values influence morality. Morality influences culture. Culture influences politics. So if we get too involved in one over the other, then what happens? If we get out of order, we lose our conscience of society. So today what we're going to do is we're going to talk about, now you know what to expect from your church, but since you're a part of your church, if you're a follower of Christ, you've been redeemed, then you are a part of the church. What is your responsibility as an individual politically? So today, just to let you know, is we are going to, you know, do Bible study and a little application, but at the very, very end, you know, it's kind of adult content. So if you have a little one about, you know, if there's 5-10 minutes to go, send them out to get a cookie and it'll all be good. So that's what we're going to try to do is answer the question, what does Jesus expect of you or of me as an individual when it comes to politics? And with everything, we always start with Bible study. What does the Bible teach first? And then we figure out, once we understand the principles, how are they applied? Number one thing that you are called to as a follower of Christ is called discipleship. You are called to walk and follow Jesus, okay? And this is basically aligning my core values with the values of Jesus Christ. The more I grow to maturity in my faith, the stronger I become. And what happens is the less I am manipulated or tossed here and there by, you know, strange ideas or ideologies, it gives me the capacity to think clearly. And that's very important. So discipleship is what matures me as a person. Paul directly describes this process for every follower of Christ in Ephesians chapter 4, and I will read it for you. In verse 11, he basically says, look, God gave leadership to the church to do something, and this is what they're supposed to do, beginning with verse 12. They are to equip God's people for works of service. So equip means they are to coach, they are to instruct, they are to inspire, they are to encourage and give opportunity. Okay, so they are to equip every follower of Christ who is a part of the church for works of ministry. That's where the word service is translated from. So you have a ministry, and the purpose of leadership is to help you discover your ministry, which we call your purpose in life, and to start employing it, because that's where your life really comes into focus. And you go, wow, this is, man, I'm doing what I'm, wow, this is awesome. And you'll see and experience a lot of what God is doing in you and through you as an affirmation of this maturation process. He says, now here's why you need to grow in your ministry, so that the body of Christ may be built up. So God is building up the church, and he has for 2,000 years, until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God. So there's something that happens in the discipleship process that is involving your brain, because it's the knowledge of the Son of God. All right? He goes on to say, we are to become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So the more mature I grow, then the more I obtain the full measure of everything in Christ Jesus. All right? And if you go back to chapter 1, he talks about, of Ephesians, he talks about every spiritual blessing has been sowed upon you. Well, I don't know about you, but sometimes when I'm going through life, I'm thinking, man, I'm not experiencing any spiritual blessing right now. I mean, life is really stressful. It's filled with anxiety, difficulties, and struggles. And you're like, where is that? Well, sometimes bad times or difficult times grow and mature us, right? So that we go on to discover the full measure of everything we have in Christ. Now, why do we want to do this? And this is where he gets really specific. He goes, listen to verse 14. We will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves, blown here and there by every wind of teaching, and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. Well, there you go. He says the reason we want to grow mature is that, number one, we are not children anymore, right? Where, you know, you're just like the kids, you know, cookie, rah, and they go running off, you know? And that can happen sometimes in our adult age. We do not want to be taken in by every wind of teaching. When someone stands up and says, man, I'm going to do this, or this is going on, and you need to be, you're like, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? You use your brain a little bit and think, okay, wait a second, let's reason through this and see what God intends to do. He says, because there are people, right, who are scheming in a deceitful way. They're cunning and they are crafty. So that means that when people are trying to convince me of something, I need to be aware. You know, there's a perfect thing. I'm sure you've heard this before. My grandpa said it to me. So, you know, people used to say, hey, can I talk to you for a second? I want to teach you how to double your money, right? And so grandpa, you say the best way to double your money is take it out of your wallet, fold it over, and stick it back in your pocket. So that's just it, you know. I mean, how many of you, I'd like to know, ever bought anything from Ronco? Anybody about anything? The pocket fisherman, you know, any of that stuff? Okay. Some people are going, what's he talking about? Okay, that dates me a little bit, right? So the thing is that those are just, you know, light-hearted schemes, but there are all kinds of schemes going on. There's all kinds of ideologies that are floating around out in the world today, and they are designed to do what? Convince us of something. He goes on to say this. He goes, verse 15, instead, speaking the truth in love, we will grow up to every respect into the mature body of him who is the head, that is Christ. So discipleship achieves growth and maturity in you over a period of time, and you are not tossed here and there by every wind of teaching or doctrine. It's not a, discipleship is not a crash diet. You can't lose 50 pounds in 50 days. It's not P90X. It's going to get you shredded in 90 days, you know? It's not going to happen. Discipleship is about discovering a new way of thinking and living and perceiving life. And what it does is it fills you with purpose and meaning. Discipleship heals you as it matures you. So sometimes maturation is healing from the old and then learning the new, right? It's very important to do that. So many years ago, I was talking to a gal. She's a lovely young gal, and she was single. And she was saying, I was talking to her, you know, teasing her a little bit about, you know, her future. Is there a guy in your life? You know, anybody, if you got a guy, can I set you up? And she goes, you know, I'm really not ready for that. I've had a number of really bad relationships. And she said, I need to mature to the point where my radar for men is recalibrated. I go, what do you mean by that? She goes, I seem to be attracted to the wrong kind of men. And so I thought, well, you know, that's really interesting because it reflects what it's talking about here. You need to heal and then mature. This is what discipleship does for you. In Romans chapter 12, verse 2, Paul says that we need to be transformed by the renewal of our mind. How do you renew your mind? You know, you have to slowly get rid of old thoughts and ideas and things, and then you need to fill them with the truth. And why do we do this? Why do we want to grow to maturity? Well, the end result is joy. The end result is joy. I call it in spite of joy, because joy is different than happiness. The reason I want to grow deeper in my faith, I want to become more mature, I want to align my values with Jesus Christ, is because I want joy. C.S. Lewis talked about this a lot. He said that the ultimate thirst of your soul is joy. In spite of joy means I experience joy in spite of what's going on around me. The ups and downs, the tossed here and there by every wind of teaching doesn't impact me anymore because my joy is set. It's in spite of joy, in spite of the chaos of this world. It's in spite of the setbacks and tragedies. Everybody has difficulties, problems, curveballs, tragedies in your life. It just is going to happen. I guarantee it. How do you have joy in the midst of those difficulties? Well, by maturing through discipleship in your faith. It's in spite of joy, in spite of failed dreams or unmet expectations. So the first thing to understand is this may sound strange, if God has an expectation about me in being involved in politics, it begins with me walking in discipleship with Christ first. Because if I don't do this first, then everything that I think and try to do downstream of this is going to get off track. It might be a little polluted. It might be a little askew. So start here and then go there. What's the next step then? Well, we are called in America to participate in politics whether we want to or not. Now, let me say that again, and then let me build my case, and then you make up your own mind. We are called to participate in politics in America whether we want to or not. Now, what is my case? Well, let's see what the Bible teaches. The first thing I want to do is I want to go to Matthew chapter 22, verse 21. Students of Pharisees are trying to trick Jesus, you know, like, should we pay taxes or not? Kind of a thing like this. And so it's an age-old story, you probably heard it. Jesus says, give me a coin. And he says to him, well, whose likeness is on it? And they say, Caesar's. And then Jesus replies in chapter 22, verse 21, he says, so give back to Caesar what is Caesar's and to God what is God's. And what he's basically saying here is very important. He's saying, look, there is the government of men, and then there is God's kingdom. They are different, but we have responsibility to both. Render unto Caesar what is Caesar's, so responsibility there. Render unto God what is God's, responsibility there. Now, if we jump over to Romans chapter 13, Paul talks about something that is really interesting. In verse 1, he says this, let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority that which has been established by God. Okay? The authorities that exist have been established by him. Okay? Now, if you jump down to verse 6, he goes on to say, this is why you pay taxes. A lot of people didn't know that that was in the New Testament. Doggone it. You know, when you own a business, you work for yourself and you pay estimated taxes, those are the most painful checks that you write. Okay? This is why you pay taxes, for the authorities are God's servants who give their full time to governing. You give to everyone what you owe them. If you owe taxes, pay your taxes. If revenue, then revenue. If respect, then respect. If honor, then honor. What's interesting, so that's Paul. He teaches that. And then Peter, in his book, we just went over this a little bit ago, he says something very similar, all right? And I think what's interesting about this is Peter wrote this when Nero, the emperor, was persecuting Christians on the basis of a lie. He accused them of a false crime, and that was burning the city of Rome. But listen to what he says in chapter 2 of verse 13, okay? He says, submit yourself for the sake of the Lord. Now, not for the sake of the governing authority. It's for the sake of God. To every human authority, whether to the emperor as a supreme authority, in verse 14 says, or to governors who are sent by him. So it's really interesting. Jesus says, there's kingdoms of men, governments of men, and there is the kingdom of God. They're different, but you have responsibility to both. Peter and Paul, both authors of the New Testament, speaking through the divine revelation of Jesus Christ, says this, we are to submit to the authorities, okay? And it was written in the context of the Roman dictatorship or oligarchy. You could make that argument, but predominantly it was a dictatorship. And their main point was this. This is very important to understand their main point. They're not saying submit to the government because the dictator is God, and you're supposed to, that's not what he's saying. He's saying, look, submit to the government because you cannot use Christianity as the basis for every political revolution that you want. So it's in contrast to the Jewish nationalism that was going around, right? Just prior to this, the Jews had been ejected from Rome because they were constantly trying to overthrow the Roman government. Now, why is this significant? If you want to dig into this, this is biblical scholarship. Everybody kind of agrees on that. And here's why I really want to build my case. And I really want you to catch this. Most people don't, because this is never taught in our society ever. And there's a reason why. And as I lay out this case, you will probably understand why. Our founding fathers knew those verses. Our founders knew the Bible better than most pastors who preach it today. When you go back and you read what they actually wrote and why they did what they did, they understood the scriptures. Today, there's a movement to say, well, they were deists or they were agnostics, and which is silliness. But even if they were, it's irrelevant to the fact that they knew the Bible. Thomas Jefferson knew the Bible so well that he went through a manuscript of the Bible and he cut out all the parts he didn't like and then kept the ones he liked and made his own Bible to read every day. Now, you might think that's kind of a bad thing, and you might think that that's silly. Okay, but let me tell you something. How do you cut out the parts you don't like if you don't know you don't like them? Meaning, he knew exactly what they said. All of our founders knew the Bible. They knew it front and back. And they knew, when you read the Federalist Papers and the founding documents of our nation, you know and see for a fact that they knew these verses were used to oppress people over and over, and that they were used to oppress people by monarchs and rulers and kings and lords who pulled those verses out of context. The first rule of all interpretation is to answer the question, who was this written to, right? It's very important when you're talking about husbands and wives and how to get along, right? Because husbands tend to read the passages of scripture that are written for his wife. And whenever they get in an argument, what do they always do? They always say, honey, you're supposed to submit to me. You're supposed to respect me. You know, and I tell women, well, when he says that, you said, you're reading the wrong part of the Bible. That was written to me. Are you a wife? Well, no. Are you a female? No. Okay, let's read what was written. And she'll say, well, what you're supposed to do is you're supposed to die for me like Jesus died for the church. And then he's supposed to say, okay, that was written for me and not for you. See, the problem is when we read what was written to us, and ignore that and read what was written to somebody else and try to get them to do it, that is pulling it out of context, okay? And so the biggest pull out of context for this passage of scripture was King Henry VIII when he passed this thing called the Divine Right of Kings. And you know what he said? Is that you have to submit to me because God told you to submit to me because of my bloodline. I was set apart divinely by God to rule over you. And he called it the Divine Right of Kings. Louis XIV in France practiced this. James, King of the Scots, he practiced this. Everybody believed that this was the divine right, that God had chosen this bloodline to rule over everybody else, you see. If you remember the first movie of the Avengers, you know, Loki, the instigator shows up, you know, in Germany, and he says, oh, you people, you need to assume your position of subservience. You are meant to be ruled, right? And we laugh at that and think, oh, he's so silly, and young people look and laugh at that. I hate to tell you this, but that was the predominant attitude in all human civilization up to 250 years ago. When you go back and read history, that was the predominant principle, is that these verses were used by rulers, but these verses weren't written to rulers, were they? They were written to those who were living under their tyranny. You see, our founders knew this. And you know what it did? It forced them to think, to pray, and debate for 12 years to come up with a system that honored these biblical principles, these biblical passages, and their true intent. Most people are not aware of this, but the Declaration of Independence was signed in what year? 1776, right? Do you know when the Constitution of the United States was ratified? 1788. That's 12 years later. What happened during that period of time? Our founders knew these verses. And so our founders said, how do we honor these verses? Because people aren't going to throw their Bibles out and just follow into this new nation. How do we honor these verses while at the same time understand their true intent? And what they did is they came up with a principle, an idea that had not been used in human history. And it was an experiment, they called it. It was the great gamble, and that is, can human beings govern themselves instead of being ruled by individuals? All right? Self-rule. It was a radical idea, and this is why the very essence of the Constitution was written the way it was written. Every Constitution up to that point ever devised, developed, grants powers to the ruler over those being ruled. Only the American Constitution, unique in its development, acknowledged the pre-existing rights of human beings and the authority of the people, that the only reason you can lead them or rule over them is because they give you their consent. It is the consent of the people. This is a radical idea of self-governance. So the Constitution limits the government from infringing upon these rights. That's why it's the most radical political document that has ever been written in the history of the world. So here's my case. This is why it is your responsibility and my responsibility to be involved in politics, whether we want to or not. Because the Constitution, not the president, not the Congress, not the governor, not our state legislature, not the Idaho Supreme Court, not the Supreme Court of the United States of America. None of those are our authority. Our authority is the Constitution of the United States, and we have been told and admonished by Peter and Paul that we are to submit to what? The governing authority, and that's the Constitution. And the Constitution says that you and I, as citizens, have a duty to participate in our politic. The Constitution says that we are to do things. We have certain responsibilities. And if we don't fulfill those responsibilities, then the Constitution loses its authority. I got a quote here. I think it's up here on the thing from Thomas Jefferson in a letter to Edward Carrington, wrote in 1787. And he says, cherish, therefore, the spirit of our people. So he's saying, look, this is about the people. It's not about government. Keep alive their attention. So we need to remember our responsibility. Keep our mental attention on our responsibility as citizens. If once they become inattentive to the public affairs, you and I and Congress and assemblies, judges and governors will become wolves. Listen to what he's saying. He says, when the people stop paying attention to politics, the political leaders become wolves. The wolves will devour you. The wolves will tell you what you can do, when you can do it. They'll tell you what to believe and how to believe it. And if you don't listen, then they will use force to make you comply. So Thomas Jefferson, at the founding of our country, said, this is the law of our general nature. This is the law of our general nature. It will happen if we don't participate according to the authority of the Constitution. He goes on to say in a second quote, in a letter to William Stephen Smith, he says, lethargy or laziness is the forerunner of death to the public liberty. That's my case. Paul, Peter says, we must submit to the governing authority. The governing authority in the United States of America is not a human being. It's not a president. It is the Constitution of the United States. We are a nation of law based on the Constitution. And the Constitution dictates that you and I should be involved in it. Now, I know there are big challenges to being involved in politics. I get it. It's so divisive. You know, you have friends or maybe family members that are Democrats, some are independents, some are Republicans, and some are just plain crazy. I mean, every family has one crazy person in it, right? You know, maybe an uncle or an aunt or a nephew, who knows? You know, he got dropped on his head one too many times when he was growing up. We all have that. Every family does. That's just normal in a family. And you're thinking, I love all of my family, you know, I want them all to be together. And it's so divisive. I'd rather just stay out of it. Another reason why I think people are saying is like, it's so complicated. Why do I want to be involved in politics? It's so complicated. I don't have the time to read about politics and study the issues. I'm a single parent, and I'm trying to figure out how to get my kids to school, do their homework, and put food on the table. I don't have time for any of that. So how do you overcome these challenges and fulfill the admonition of Peter and Paul? Well, just to give you a few practical things that you can employ is, number one, stay focused on your core values. Discipleship. Keep yourself being discipled. First and foremost, it bears all this fruit spiritually in your life and brings joy in your life. But the second thing it does is it grows you in maturity and wisdom, so that when people, you know, you see a political ad on the television screen or a billboard, you don't go, oh my goodness, I got to vote for that person because the other person actually has horns growing out of his head and a devil's tail and a trident in his hand. I can't vote for that guy because he must be the devil. You go, okay, I'm not that gullible. So stay focused on your core values. The more you grow to maturity and wisdom, then the easier it is for you to navigate the complexities of politics. It really is. And it doesn't get under your skin as much as politicians would like it to be. Number two is you need to vote. Every person who follows Jesus and takes it seriously and is an American citizen should vote, because that's our civic duty. We should do it. You know, I remember a guy many, many years ago who had been a Christian a long time. I respect him a lot. And he just says, well, I never vote. It's a waste of my time. I said, it's not about your time. It's about your responsibility. You see, we are to vote. And the other reason, I understand why some people don't want to vote. It's like, well, I like to stay in the middle. I don't want to take sides. And at least I can always say, hey, I didn't vote for that. Right? Well, you didn't vote for anything, you know? So you don't have any say. You know? I remember a bumper sticker that used to be popular back in the 80s and say, don't blame me. I didn't vote for the guy. Right? And so, but look. In all honesty, people who follow Christ say, look, we're going to vote. I'm going to try and understand the issues. And I'm just going to stick with the basics. I don't understand foreign policy. I don't understand the military industrial complex and how much it's funded by the Pentagon. I don't understand these massively complex issues. But if I understand my core values and I'm going to vote, I think in good conscience, I can pray about it and God is going to lead me in how to vote. The third thing is, don't worship politicians. People worship always ends poorly, you know? It always ends poorly, whether it's a teacher or a coach or it's a pastor or a politician. They're just human beings. And the authority that they're exercising is not their own intrinsic authority. It's authority that has been granted to them by the laws and the systems of our society. You know, the other thing too is this, is each and every day, I just want to encourage you, is that remember that the majority of Americans are not your enemy. You know, I just have to state for the record that people who go to BYU are not my enemy. Now, on game day, you might think so, right? Because they're always messing with my Broncos, right? But in reality, they're not. And I think we need to keep that perspective a little bit. If you're involved in politics and you're really engaged in it, you should play as hard as you can. You should be involved as much as you can, be as wise and as brilliant and strategic as you possibly can, but have integrity in the way you do it. Because the thing is that, you know, your goal at a BYU Bronco game is to defeat the guys on the field. Your goal isn't to defeat all the fans after the game who drove up here to see the game, right? You don't want to throw tomatoes at them and run them off the road. That's just ridiculous. People would look at that and go crazy. I think we need to get back to that kind of idea, you know. Hey, politics is like football without rules. I mean, it's a brutal, bloody game. It just is. You know, whenever if you're around football, boy, you get down there on the sideline, you watch collegiate or professional football, it is a brutal game. The way those guys hit each other, I mean, they are, in the same way as politics. But the fans of the team are not the enemy. They're your brothers and sisters. They are future family members in the kingdom of God. That's how I look at them. They're future family members. So I must look at people that way. But you know what? Make no mistake. There are people who get out there on the field who are enemies of the gospel. And I shared this before, is that the church is so big and so powerful and so influential from God's perspective. Everybody either loves it or they hate it and want to control it and destroy it. And they specifically want to do it. And so as a Christian, they're going to want to go after you. Not everybody, not all Americans, but a very small people who are interested in power and control. In 2 Timothy chapter 2, some of the very last words that Paul ever penned and put to paper was this. Mark this. There will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful and proud, abusive. They will be disobedient to their parents. They will be ungrateful and unholy. They will have no love. They will be unforgiving. They will be slanderous. They have no self-control. They're brutal, absolutely brutal. They are not lovers of good. They are treacherous. They're rash. They're so conceited, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. Have nothing to do with these people. They have a form of godliness, but they deny its power. Have nothing to do with these people. You know, I want you to think through some things. Like I said before, my goal is not to tell you what to think, who to vote for, but my goal is to help you figure out how to get closer to Christ and think critically for yourself. But I just want you to think through some things. I'd like to think through the issue of abortion real quick, okay? Abortion has been practiced in America for over 150 years. It became medically viable probably around 1930, 1940. And then what happened after that is the Supreme Court ruled it a federal right because some states allowed it and some states didn't. In 1972, in a landmark case called Roe versus Wade. Up until about 8 or 9 years ago, everybody in our society agreed that abortion was a moral wrong. Okay, they all agreed. The question was, well, do you want it to be safe and legal or not legal? So that was where the debate was. Well, in the last probably 6 to 7 years, the debate on it has totally changed. I just want you to think about this for a second. Because the Supreme Court has now said, actually, that's not a federal right. It needs to go back to the states so that they can decide. Well, California has decided that they want to be a place that abortion is made readily available. Okay? They have a right to do that. They elected their leaders. Their leaders represent them. That's what they voted for. That's not what I want you to think about. This is what I want you to think about. Is this is an ad that California has put out, and I want to show you a picture. And it says this. It says, do you need an abortion? California is ready to help. Visit abortion, and they give the thing there. And then notice what they put on their billboard. Jesus, Mark 12, 31, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no greater commandment than these. So we are now quoting Jesus for the purpose of saying abortion is a moral good, and Jesus puts his stamp of approval on it. Do you believe me when I say Jesus is being used as a political football? And people who don't know Jesus, people who don't know what Jesus taught, will look at that and go, that makes total sense to me. Another thing that's happening in our world today, like I said, small groups of people, you know, I'm not interested in having arguments and fights with the fans of BYU, right? But there are players on the field that are playing, and those people are dangerous. One of the questions that I get as a pastor today more and more is, why in the world is our public education system sexualizing kids so much? I mean, it just seems crazy. Why is California and Oregon and Washington and Illinois and Massachusetts and Connecticut and Virginia and all these places wanting to introduce all these gender ideologies and transitioning to kindergartners and first graders and second graders? Why are they doing that? That just seems crazy. Well, the reason why it is happening is because in 2000, George W. Bush was elected to office and he started a curriculum called Abstinence Only to be taught as sexual education in our public school system. And then in 2008, the Obama administration was elected. I'm not saying Obama was good or bad, I'm just saying what they did. And the Obama administration in 2009 commissioned a new group. They took $200 to $300 million out of the federal abstinence-only sexual education, and they transferred it to what they called this new sexual education standards for the country, okay? And so that happened in 2009. And what's interesting is under these standards, it was a consortium of organizations, the Future of Sex Education Initiative, core content and skills for K through 12. It was led by Advocates for Youth, CECAS, American Association of Health, the American School Health Association, the National Education Association, Health Information Network, and the Society of State Leaders. They state that 45% of school districts have adopted these standards. And right there for the National Sex Education Standards, it says, you can go Google, look it up there, it has the following quote. This is what our goal is. So the goal is to ground the educational experience in social justice and equity. Okay? Honoring the diversity of students. We want to honor their racial diversity. Well, I think that's a really good thing, right? We want to their ethnic diversity. I like that. Their gender diversity. So this is where the gender ideology and why it's being taught to kindergartners, their sexual orientation, their ability, socioeconomic as well as academic, and promote awareness, understanding, and appreciation of diversity and inclusion. So that's where it's coming from, and that's why it's happening. So do you need to be aware of everything political to exercise good judgment? No. But when you vote, I think you ought to take 10 or 15 minutes, do a little research, and you'll find out a world of things. Because guess what? Not every person out there is an enemy of the gospel. We should look at the majority of people as future family members. But we also need to be wise and realize that there are small groups of people who this is their life goal. And they are enemies of the gospel. They're enemies of your way of life, and they're enemies of everything that you hold dear and you value. And that's why you can't sit on the sidelines anymore.
We hope that this teaching from the Bible is helping you understand why we should look for truth and wisdom in all things, not just politics. If you are visiting on campus or watching online for the first time, be sure to learn more about us by texting FHNEW to 72000. We would love to have you be a part of our family. Also, stay tuned after the blessing for our brand new post-sermon discussion group where you can listen to other members of Foothills discuss today's message live and chat with them about all the things you learned from today's teaching. Now let's stand for our closing blessing.
Lord Jesus, we're just asking that you show us, that you lead us, you guide us to be people of joy, people who are walking in a new love of you, God, and what this translates into and how we need to navigate this world. Teach us, God. Amen. God bless you and see you next Sunday.
Hello, hello, hello. Good morning, and thanks so much for joining us here at Foothills. Today we are doing the discussion questions program here. I'm super excited to have a couple new guests today. This is Mike and this is Emma Fulmer. And we're going to be hanging out for a little bit talking about some heated stuff. Really excited that Foothills is putting on this discussion questions program in this kind of format. What's really cool about it is that we're just kind of people talking. We don't prepare too much. We just kind of go over the same discussion questions that are in your Foothills app. So scroll down to the bottom. And you can actually join us. If you go ahead and go to YouTube and hit the comments section, I'll be babysitting that down here while we're answering a bunch of questions. So if you guys want to join us, I'd love to hear from you guys. Just go down to the live chat and we'll be hanging out. We did start this discussion questions on a pretty heated subject. We actually got it started right next to the new program that we're 3 weeks into called My Political Jesus. Lot of information to catch up on if this is your first service. Definitely consider not only looking up at the last videos, but also the Salty Pastors on Tuesdays and Thursdays in the history. That'll catch you up on where we're at now. But we're getting started after a lot of heat at the end of that service with the first question on your discussion questions, which is, what was the most interesting point in today's teaching for you?
I mean, I had my answer all set, but then Doug just ended with some convicting things. Originally, I was going to say God wants to grow and mature us. That's what Doug had talked about earlier, and how hard that is. I mean, that's never an easy thing. I'm always cautious when I pray for patience because I know he's going to put something for me to grow my patience right in front of me. So, it's hard. Growth is hard, and it usually comes with, some trial and pain and some struggle, but it's definitely important. And I think we have to continue pushing ourselves to grow amateur.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And I just love that Doug also talked about, those hard questions and discussion, and topics. I don't feel like a lot of people, really dive into it or feel like they can. So I love this whole setup. I love this series, and I love that we're doing the discussion questions too.
I totally agree with you. I think that it's something that we all want to go to church and relax and hang out and enjoy community and hang out together. But sometimes growth comes with some of that stuff where you got to kind of check yourself and be educated, right?
Right.
And that comes with some growing pains. Mike, what about you, bud? What do you got for question one?
Well, there was an interesting point the pastor pointed out in today's sermon, and it was the importance of discipleship and also knowing, aligning it with Jesus. You know, that's very important, and you have to know what you're actually discipling for. So often we forget that the spiritual development is one of the most fundamental things to focus on. And if we're able to influence, impact the sphere of people that we're around in our daily lives and communities, it's just that much more that we can push for, Jesus and for what we believe in.
Yeah. I mean, spiritual development. Let me ask you this real quick. What does that look like? How do you know you're developing? Because I as a young Christian, when I was just kind of growing into the faith, people would say things like, develop your spirit, lay this at the foot of God. And I would struggle with those because I'm like, you tell me how I'll do it. I just don't know what I'm looking for. So what does that mean?
Yeah, absolutely. I think for me, it is finding what's important to me, what I'm comfortable talking about when in the fields and the people that I'm with, and just being able to express, the little knowledge that I have and sharing that, and hopefully it's impactful. And even if it's not, it may be to someone that you'd least expect.
Mm-hmm. I think that's a good point to know that at any point you could be like a conduit for Christ and be able to
Absolutely.
Speak to people. And a lot of the times you remember the day where that happened to you, right? And you have that moment where you're like, dude, it would be so cool to be this for God for somebody.
Absolutely.
And like, once you walk away from that moment, you're like pumped, you're like jacked. You're like, I did it. Well, glory to God, right? So for me, when I read that question, I kind of played with it a little bit. But I think what it came down for me is that one of the most interesting points that he brought up was being responsible to both the church, Christ, and politics. And I think it's easy as Christians to be like, you know what, you know, I all my time is spent with Jesus, you know, I put all my time into the spiritual realm, and politics, you know, it's just people being dumb. Like that's why it almost is a great excuse to back up and say, I don't really care for politics. I spend too much time with Jesus in my small groups in my church and stuff to care about all that stuff. Mm-hmm. But we are called into that. And we've all heard what Doug brought up, which was that, you know, the Caesar give to him what is his and give to God what belongs to him. That verse that kind of covers that. I've always remembered that I'm made in the image of Christ, but he didn't say only give to Jesus, only give to, like, he did say give to Caesar what belongs to him. And so it is kind of our responsibility to be educated, but like we covered in the last two services, where's your North Star? Like, what's your foundation built on? And is what you're doing to glorify God or not, right? And we'll cover a little bit on some of these other questions, but that's kind of what I think about is, okay, I do have a responsibility here. And sometimes that's a hard pill to swallow, because that means you got to pick a side. That means you got to have friends, which means you got to have enemies sometimes, with especially in politics, right? Yeah. So going on to question two, I'll toss it your way, Mike, since we got Emma to start earlier.
Sure.
How does what you learned affect your political involvement?
Well, God calls us to be the salt and light in this world and to stand for what is right according to what we think and according to God's laws. And I think the best way is to get involved politically on the local level, on your sphere where you're around, whether it's starting with just saying things to your kids or maybe the neighbors, yes. But not pushing too much there. But I mean, just getting involved in charities, organizations, things that impact others. Yeah. And I think that's a great way to just get your foot in the door,
yeah,
and get you more comfortable to bigger things when you're more knowledgeable on the subjects that you're really passionate on.
I love that, because I think what people get misunderstood about is that not all politics are so crazy controversial, especially local. You can talk to somebody who's so passionate on one position on a national field, but when it comes to local, there's something worth gnawing on, and you have an impact on your actual home. Like, global politics can seem way overwhelming, and you'll throw your vote into the bucket and hope it goes your way. But locally, you have a lot more control over something that directly impacts you tomorrow. Like, so I think that's a really good call. And starting local and communicating locally with it is a great way to get started. So, Emma, what's your story?
And even before that, how you had talked about discipleship as talking with the people in your groups. It's just even talking to your friends and saying things that they might not have thought of and being confident in that, and also just focusing on the people around you in that time and what you can do to make a difference in that moment. I can get overwhelmed by politics, and I think really focusing on just my community here at church and then also in my neighborhood where my kids are homeschooled, so I don't have the school side of things, but I feel like there's just people that you run into each and every day, and God puts those people in front of you. I mean, you kind of know who God wants you to talk to, so I think it's important to just be brave and confident in that and start the conversation.
Yep. And I think that's brave and confident comes from a passion, right?
Right.
But what I learned from this one and kind of think about more now is that don't confuse passion with progress. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you can be passionate about something, but if you're not zooming out and looking at where that's coming from, that might just be some sort of selfish desire or some sort of judgment you made a long time ago, and you got to zoom out and be like, okay, where's my foundation? Where's my North Star right now? Because right now I'm super passionate, but why?
Right.
And is this glorifying God? I think we have a bunch of comments already coming in on the live chat, so I just want to shout out a few things here. We have Karen saying, it's important to know who is being addressed. By the way, that includes billboards. Definitely agree with that. I think it's imperative that we remember that nothing is all good or all bad. We need to remember that so we don't demonize those on the other side of the political field. That one was from Cammy. Cammy's a common commenter.
Well, and how convicting was it when Doug said, I wrote it down, remember that the fans in the game that you're cheering alongside with are future family members in the kingdom of God. Wow, that is convicting.
Jesus died for them too, right? For sure. Thank you, Cammy. We also have a couple more I'll throw out real quick. Karen, Matthew declares that the governments are on the shoulders of Jesus. That's why we view the politics as a command to engage. Really good answer to the second question there. Got some more comments. I'll hit them up in just a second, but keep them coming. I love this stuff. We'll roll on to I believe question three. What is the most important thing you can do politically regarding your faith? Who wants to kick that one off? You want me to?
I guess. Sure.
Awesome. Yeah, go for it.
My biggest thing is slow down. I think that's what I think about this stuff is like slow down, pray, and be educated. But don't stop there. You need to act. You need to vote. You need to be engaged to a certain level. I love the locally. I'm totally with you on that one. Know what's going on in your kid's school, what's going on even in your local neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. And we have politics beyond, like, even in HOAs and stuff here that we can be involved in, right? We all roll our eyes to that. But, I mean, being involved shouldn't be the first thing you do. I think it's important to pray and educate and then get involved. But don't just pray and educate.
Right.
You got to do something with it. That's right. What I stuck on. Who's up next?
I'll go.
Love it.
I think for me in anything that I do, I have to be confident in order to feel like I'm making an impact or at least giving my full effort. And I think that it's going to start with studying and being knowledgeable and aligning everything with what I have, what my calling is and what God has blessed me with that I'm good at, and to try and use that as my spear and to try and get in there and be impactful in the most positive way that I can. And I just have to hit the books is basically my answer.
That's good. Yeah, be educated.
Absolutely.
We talked about that on the first service where we all have a passion, right? About whatever it might be. But the last thing you want to do is only be passionate and someone put a microphone in your face. Mm-hmm. And then you're like,
yeah, I got to be prepared.
You have to get out of here as quick as possible. Yeah. Emma, what do you think?
I think, again, the alone time, really focusing on yourself and the learning and just being confident, but also being open to other ideas. I know I've politically changed my ideas over the years. Mm-hmm. As I've grown closer in my relationship with God, I've really gone away from a lot of ideas that I was raised with. So that was surprising to me and also to others. And I've really focused on what my values are with Jesus and God and as a Christian, you know, what I should be focusing on. And it was very different from how I had kind of grown up with. So it was humbling and scary. And but I think it gives me confidence in that, knowing that I kind of did the work and did the time of really connecting with God and also learning more and just being open to that other idea, not just pushing our agenda, but also listening and being open to other people's ideas.
Well, it's kind of crazy that once you recognize and start growing your faith with Christ, it's listening and opening up to the idea of Christ. That's where you have to start, right? Because then your foundation is built and you're pointed in a direction that you can actually engage with on a spiritual level. And I think what's really cool about what you brought up is that you gained a perspective. Mm-hmm. And that's, we're all trying to do that. To me personally, when I spend time with the Lord, it's the best thing I gain is a perspective. It's like realizing all the stuff you put your heart out to might be dumb, useless, or maybe some materials or whatever it might be. Is you gain a perspective of Jesus. And when you take that with you into your politics, I think that's what you get to do, is you get to mature and grow there too, right? So that's an awesome call out. We have a lot going on in chat that I feel like I got to call out here. Karen says, I'm compelled to call out those who set themselves up as equal to Jesus, our Savior. It's a huge call out. Also, we have one from Misty saying, it's so hard to know what is right when voting because both sides are being influenced. Mm. So that's a good call out. And then we have Cammy responding to Misty, which is fantastic. I love that the chat's not just going here. It's going all over the place. Cammy says, I agree with Misty. As a new American, I found it difficult to do the research necessary to be informed, particularly at the local level. So sometimes local information is harder to get a hold of. Mm. And then search facts, pray, parse words for impact on the emotions or logic. So that's, I mean, we're talking, once we get politics going, we get chat going, I love it. Keep engaged with us. I love including you guys. Before we wrap this up, as we go on, does anybody want to have any closing thoughts, something they're going to nod as we walk away? Tough one. It's a new question.
I thought of something based off of my answers. And I need to be prepared for Thanksgiving upcoming because you have all of the family coming over and this is when all of the politics meld.
Yes.
And you already know how certain, you know, Aunt Thelma thinks or how Uncle Bob is. And mm-hmm. you just know there's certain topics you stay away from.
Sure.
But I think it's really cool to just kind of combat it as like a strategy, you know, and be knowledgeable and know what you're going to come out and be respectful. But it's a fun little little self-task I'm going to try this year.
Should be fun.
It's a good reminder. It's a great reminder. And to pray over the dinner and everyone at it.
Yes, absolutely.
Yes, lots of prayer. Start with prayer. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us here. This has been a really fun one. I really enjoy the conversation and chat. Keep it coming. Share this with folks if they want to hear it. Just know that there's different thoughts and different ideas, different opinions, even at this table and through the community, and I love hearing it on chat. Again, thanks so much, and we'll catch you next week.